Yeah, good evening, guys. Can you hear me? Yeah, so last class we started with hydrogen and we were doing the preparation of hydrogen, correct? The first method that we have done is by the action of water on active metals. Okay. Yeah. So we'll continue with this chapter, hydrogen, today. We'll finish it off and then we'll start with S block, that is group one. Okay, so we have seen that active. Yeah, Pranav, I got it. Okay, see, actually, what happens, that report, no advanced assignment, that report is system generated. Okay, if you have not submitted on time, and if it is some submission is done from our side, then your name won't be there. Okay, we can't do anything into it. So those who have shared with me your assignment personally, like we have the database, don't worry. Okay. The thing is, the report that we generate, it is system generated. Okay, we can't change it. So for this time, you let it be as it is. Next time onwards, you submit it on time. Okay. Like suppose it's 10th is the date, so by 10th morning you must submit. Better if 9th evening you'll submit. But I'll try to submit on my side or the assignment on 10th evening or by night. Okay, so you have that 10th proper, like entire day you have with you. Understood, Pranav? Yes, so we have done with the first method, that is amalgamated metal we use in order to reduce the rate of the reaction so that the chance of catching fire will be less. Okay, that is what happened in the first method. When the reaction proceeds, it is highly exothermic reaction, huge amount of energy releases, right? So in order to reduce that, we use amalgamated metal. Okay. Now, the second method of preparation, all of you write down. The second method we have by using alkali solution. By using alkali solution. Write down metals like beryllium, zinc, tin, aluminium, etc. Reacts with boiling alkali solution. Boiling alkali solution and liberates hydrogen. Okay, reaction you see. Beryllium with NaOH, 2NaOH. When you heat this, it forms Na2, BeO2, and H2 releases. This compound we call it as sodium berylate. Okay. Similarly, if you have zinc, reacts with NaOH, 2NaOH gives Na2, ZnO2, that is sodium zincate, and hydrogen gas releases sodium zincate. Okay, these are the reaction we have for the preparation of hydrogen with alkali solution. Copy this down, go to the next slide. Type of metals, as in what can we say? These are active metals, we can say. Transition metal, also zinc is a transition metal. Okay. Magnesium, beryllium is an active metal. Aluminiums, the metallic property is lesser if you compare with all other elements. So these, you know, metals have different behavior. But one property is common, they have tendency to release electrons. Correct? Next slide down. The third method of preparation. By action of dilute acids on certain metal. Dilute acid on certain metal. Write down metals which are more electropositive. Metals which are more electropositive than hydrogen atom reacts with dilute acids and evolve hydrogen. For example, you see, we have zinc. Zinc react with H2SO4 dilute acid. Can say that, yes, displaces hydrogen. It is ZnSO4 plus H2 gas releases here, right? Displacement reaction also it is. Similarly, if you take Fe with HCl, dilute gives FeCl2 plus H2. One question that they ask in this, here, if you take copper plus H2SO4 dilute, and if you write CuSO4 plus H2, this reaction is not possible. It does not release hydrogen because copper is not more electropositive than hydrogen. It cannot displace hydrogen from dilute acid. Okay, done. The reason for this too is why zinc can displace, why not copper, is the reduction potential. Okay. For example, if you see, if I write down the reduction potential of copper, copper when converts from Cu2 plus to Cu, its reduction potential is 0.34 volt. The reduction potential of zinc, Zn2 plus to Zn, is minus 0.76 volt. And the reduction potential of water plus to H2, this is zero. Right? So those metals which has lesser reduction potential than hydrogen are more electropositive and can displace hydrogen from dilute acid. Okay. CESO form, we have different methods of preparation. There is not only one method, Nishant, right? There are other methods also by which we can prepare copper sulfate. If you want, you can write it down, this reduction potential. We'll study this particular thing in 12th grade, where we have electrode chemistry. Yeah, so these values, we'll see how do we get it. It's a relative reduction potential with respect to hydrogen. If you want, you can write it down. But this information you must keep in mind, that zinc can displace, copper cannot displace hydrogen from it. Because the reduction potential of copper is more than to that of hydrogen. That's the reason. Okay, fine. So this is the three methods of preparation we have. These are not commercial methods. Okay. See, for the preparation of any element or compound, we have various different methods. Commercial methods are those which we use in an industry in order to obtain large amount of the product. Correct? Since we are using an industry, so there are various factors. Like, for example, you know, the cost input should be less. Okay. Easy to handle. Right. Wastage is also very less, should also be less. Okay. So those kind of criteria is there in industry. Means the basic principle is we want to give minimum input and maximum output, right? So that we can make profit. So in industry, we use only those methods which are easy to handle, cost effective, plus we'll get large amount of product with minimum input, correct? So the commercial method of preparation, we have again two, three methods. The important one we are going to discuss. The first commercial method of preparation we have, that is electrolysis of water, right? So write down the heading, commercial preparation method or commercial method of preparation. Method of preparation means on a large scale, how do we prepare it? Correct. So in this, the first method we have, that is electrolysis of water. You know what is electrolysis? Electrolysis of water. Yes, So in electrolysis, what happens? Let me draw the diagram first and then we'll explain you. All of you draw this diagram. All of you draw this diagram. This is the two electrode we have. And here we have inlet of water. And in this, container, we have electrolyte present, which goes under electrolysis. Okay. This is water with 20% of NaOH. Pure water is bad conductor of electricity. To make it good conductor, we add NaOH into it, right? We can also add S2SO4 for this purpose. Okay. Now, through this electrode, we allow this current to pass through it. So we add an external source of current, that is a battery we add to this electrode of certain volt. Okay. The moment you connect with it, current passes through it. This is the positive end of the battery. This is a negative end of the battery. This rod also becomes negative because it is connected to the negative end. This rod becomes positive because it is connected to the positive end. Positive rod in electrolysis, we call it as what? Anode or cathode? Positive rod is anode. Can anode be negative also? Negative anode possible? No, is it? We have two types of cell, correct? One is electrolytic cell, other one is electrochemical cell. So in electrolytic cell, anode is negative over there. That you will again study in electrochemistry. So it's not like anode is always positive. Anode is positive in electrolytic cell. Electrolytic cell are those cells in which electrolysis takes place to obtain current. Correct? So in electrochemical cell, anode is negative. Let it be, it's not required here. Okay. And here we have an output, like we have an outlet here through which the gas can, come out through this. We have an outlet like this. Okay, so now you'll see in this, mixture, the electrolyte that we are taking, we have ions present here, right? What all ions are there? We have Na plus, OH minus, and H plus. These are the ions present. So ions that we have here, it is OH minus, Na plus, H plus. All these ions we have here. When the rod becomes negatively charged here, so automatically what happens, all these positive charge ions will attract it towards the negative electrode, that is cathode. And the negative charge ions attract towards the positive electrode, that is anode, like this. Okay. So at anode, we know whether it is negatively charged or positively charged. At anode, we always have oxidation, always oxidation. And cathode, we always have reduction. So this OH minus moves towards this anode, and at anode, the reduction takes place. Okay. So the reaction at anode is, since the OH minus we get from water, so reaction of anode is 2H2O. Oh, sorry, anode we have, no? Yeah. The reaction at anode, OH minus will go towards anode. So reaction is 2OH minus converts into H2O plus half of O2 plus 2 electron. This is the half reaction, like we did in redox reaction. Okay. The reaction at cathode, if you see, it's a reduction, so consumption of electron. So water molecule which gives H plus gets reduced at cathode, and it converts into 2OH minus and H2 at cathode. So what we are, you know, seeing over here, at anode, what happens? At anode, oxygen evolves, and at cathode, hydrogen evolves. This question they ask in the exam. So from here, H2 gas comes out, right? And from this outlet, O2 gas comes out. Okay, but there are chances of, you know, mixing of H2 and O2, and they provide again water molecule. But to prevent this mixing, we also use here an asbestos diaphragm, which separates the two part actually. You know, it does not allow the H2 and O2 to mix together. This we call it as asbestos diaphragm. The purpose of this asbestos diaphragm is to prevent the mixing of H2 and O2. This is the electrolysis of water. Copy this down. Yeah, we'll have OH minus present, like we'll have in excess. So what is the deal with that, Pranav? Tell me. No, it's not. Because OH minus is coming from H2O and NaOH, correct? So when these two dissociates, we'll get equal number of H plus and Na plus also. Initially, right? So the neutral, so the mixture will be neutral. Electrolyte will be neutral. Initially. When electrolysis starts, then it can be, maybe may not be. It depends upon how many H plus and OH minus will get reduced and oxidized respectively. Based on that, we can say. After electrolysis, you can say, but it depends, like the number of OH minus ion, Na plus and H plus is present. If equal number of H plus and OH minus will get neutralized, will get oxidized and reduced, then the solution will be what? Solution will be neutral only. So it depends upon the ionic mobility of ions also. So H plus is a little higher, contains little higher ionic mobility than OH minus. So yes, you can say after electrolysis, when the electrolysis is done or when it starts, the electrolyte will be slightly negatively charged. More number of negative ions will be there. Correct? So this is the electrolysis of water. Okay. We use here NaOH in order to make this water conductive in nature, because we know pure water is bad conductor of electricity. Yes, we can also use H2SO4 here. NaOH, or we can also use H2SO4. Understood? Yeah. Whether you use H2SO4 or you use NaOH, the product of electrolysis would be same. It won't be different. In that case also, at anode, oxygen evolves, and at cathode, hydrogen evolves. Okay, next slide down. By Bosch process. In Bosch process, one thing that they ask very often is what catalyst we use in Bosch process. The catalyst we use is nickel here. And we use very high temperature here, around 1270 Kelvin, the temperature we use. Temperature you don't have to memorize, catalyst you must remember. Okay, and in this process what happens, superheated steam superheated steam is passed over red hot coke. Okay, so we have the reaction here, carbon solid red hot coke with water in the form of steam, and it converts into CO plus H2. This is not cobalt, this is carbon monoxide. The hydrogen that we get here is impure hydrogen because of the presence of carbon monoxide in this. And this mixture, we call it as water gas. CO plus H2, important information it is. It is water gas, right? We also call it as syngas, or we also call it as synthesis gas. All are the same thing. The reaction is endothermic in nature. Endothermic in nature. Yes, understood. So since the hydrogen is impure over here and the impurity is carbon monoxide, so we need to remove this impurity in order to get the pure hydrogen. So to remove this impurity, carbon monoxide is oxidized into CO2. Okay, just give me a second. Let it be. Carbon monoxide is oxidized into CO2. So how this reaction takes place? This reaction, CO plus H2, the water gas, is further reacts with water in presence of a catalyst called iron chromate. Iron chromate is FeCrO4. This catalyst we use to oxidize carbon monoxide into CO2, and this CO2 then escapes into the atmosphere and will have H2. Done. So catalyst for Bosch process is nickel. It's not iron chromate. This we use to oxidize CO into CO2. Ni we use in the first step here. The first reaction takes place in presence of nickel. Done. Okay. Now the next method is from hydrocarbon. What do you mean by hydrocarbon? What do you mean by hydrocarbon? Compounds of hydrogen and carbon, right? Like alkane, alkene, alkyne, all this, correct? So write down. On partial oxidation of hydrocarbon, on partial oxidation of hydrocarbon, we get water gas that is CO plus H2, and then we'll remove the impurity from water gas in order to get hydrogen, pure hydrogen. And how to remove impurity, we have seen that in the last method, like Bosch process. Okay, so on partial oxidation, like for example, suppose we have an alkane, CnH2n plus 2 plus O2. When you dissolve this in water, in the form of steam basically, it converts into CO and H2, partial oxidation. If it is not partial oxidation, then it gives you directly CO2 over here, right? Balance reaction is2n plus 1. Here we have 2. Okay, so here we'll have N. And here we have 2N plus 1. That's fine. This valence reaction is this. Okay, so this is nothing but the water gas. For example, if you take methane, the hydrocarbon, dissolve in H2O in presence of nickel. Again, the catalyst, we are using nickel. It converts into CO plus 3H2, which is water gas. And from water gas, how do we obtain hydrogen? We have already seen it. Yeah, that's right. That's what we said, no, last method. This CO you need to convert into CO2 in order to remove the impurities that is CO present there. Partial oxidation is there because, you know, the complete oxidation of hydrocarbon is a bit difficult. Okay. It's not like we cannot achieve it, we cannot do it. Right. It's not like we cannot do it. But it happens, partial oxidation, the complete oxidation happens at very high temperature. And that temperature may be the CnH2n plus 2 decompose. It dissociates into carbon and hydrogen again, which is the next method of preparation we have. Ni is a catalyst. Okay. It helps in completion of reaction sooner. That is the purpose of catalyst. Catalyst always, you know, finish or completes the reaction in lesser time. Okay. We can have two types of catalyst basically, positive or negative. Positive catalyst completes the reaction at a faster rate. Negative catalyst completes the reaction, you know, it slows down the rate and the reaction takes more times to finish. Okay, so Ni here again is a catalyst. We are using this as a catalyst at some temperature, around 12 to 1300 Kelvin. Okay, and it helps the reaction to proceeds at faster rate and completes early. Okay, right. So this is the method of preparation. Then from water gas, we know how to obtain hydrogen. Okay, that's the one thing. Thermal cracking also we can do directly. In this only you write down the note over here. One note first you write down. The process of obtaining hydrogen from the process of obtaining hydrogen from the natural gas the process of obtaining hydrogen gas Hydrogen from the natural gas is called steam reforming process. It's called steam reforming process. Okay. Steam reforming process. We can also have thermal cracking of natural gas. Which means you'll take an hydrocarbon, suppose CH4 you took, and simply you heat this. Yeah, I'll repeat just a second. CH4 you take and simply you heat this, it converts into carbon and H2. This is thermal cracking. Last note, the point I said is the process of obtaining hydrogen from natural gas, is known as steam reforming process. Yeah, thermal cracking is nothing. I haven't seen anything here. It's just you take hydrocarbon and heat it. So simply on heating, hydrocarbon converts into its atomic form, that is carbon and hydrogen, like this. Okay, done. So these are the preparation method of what we say, hydrogen we have, correct? Now there are a few compounds of hydrogen we'll see. Like we have hydrides. Water and hydrogen peroxide. Okay, so before that, we'll see the properties of hydrogen. Write down properties of hydrogen. First one. It is, a colorless tasteless and odorless gas. Slightly soluble in water. It's a highly combustible gas. Burns with oxygen. With a blue flame. For example, if you write 2H2 gas and O2, it forms H2O, burns with a blue flame. It reacts with metals. And forms metal hydrides. Tell me, Pranav. Na plus H2 at around 573 Kelvin gives 2NaH. We'll talk about these hydrides again. Yes, it works with all the metals, but different nature of hydrides forms. We'll discuss that separately. So what happened, Pranav? Yeah, so what's your doubt? Still, radiations has energy, right? it dissociates the atom over there, molecule over there, and converts into the atomic form. Right, oxygen gains energy. What is SR? Achha, sir, that energy is low. What energy is low? See, when you have radiations, you can say it is a kind of similar reaction when we have, you know, the reaction, photochemical reactions, for example, we have. In presence of light, those reactions take place. So light also, it produces the homolytic cleavage and gives the atomic form of any given atom over there. Correct. So in case of radiations also, the energy is sufficient enough to provide homolysis, and oxygen converts into its atomic form. That is a nascent oxygen. Okay. So it's basically, you know, you can understand it this way. When you heat something, heating means what? You're providing energy. So radiation also, you're providing energy in the form of radiation. Light, if you strike, you're providing energy in the form of light. So all are the means of, you know, different means of providing energy, and we have different reactions here. So usually in presence of light, you know, free radical forms, atomic, you know, homolysis takes place, and we get the nascent atoms like oxygen or any other atoms we get. Same kinds of behavior we have in presence of radiations also. Okay. Write down, it reacts with halogen. Reacts with halogen and forms halides. And forms halides like H2+, plus X2, it forms 2HX. And the reactivity of halogen towards hydrogen, it is maximum for fluorine, then chlorine, then bromine, and then iodine. This is the reactivity of halogen towards hydrogen. Okay. Now, if you look at these orders here, if you talk about HF, HCl, HBr, and HI, right? The bond dissociation energy of HF is maximum. Means if you go from top to bottom, the bond dissociation energy increases because of the small size of hydrogen and fluorine. Bond dissociation energy increases like this. Okay. If you talk about bond length from fluorine to iodine, as the size increases, bond length increases. Bond length increases. Thermal stability means, if you talk about the thermal stability, This is the four order important. Must keep that in mind. Yeah, I'll tell you. Wait just a second. See, bond dissociation energy means what? The energy required to break the bond between the two atoms. To break this bond, what is the energy required here? That is bond dissociation energy. So if the bond length is more, bond dissociation energy will be less. Because larger bond you can break easily. A smaller bond is stronger and difficult to break. Right? So as the size increases, bond length increases. You see this. As the size increases, chlorine, chlorine, bromine, iodine, bond length increases. Bond length increases, so bond dissociation energy decreases. So bond dissociation energy is maximum for HF. Bond dissociation energy is maximum, hence its thermal stability is maximum. Right? And if you remember, I have discussed the acidic order in GOC, the first chapter that we did. It is because of the size of anion. Done? Understood this? No doubt. Could you tell me the reason behind this acidic order? I have discussed it. Tell me. Yeah, but why is that so? Mahadev, that's wrong. Okay, if you recall, in GOC we have discussed this. How it will happen then, if you forget like this, the things. How many of you have revised GOC in the recent days? Honestly, you tell me. Yes, if you haven't revised, you can type in no at least. Okay, only Pranav, you have done. Okay, so if you won't, yeah, Aditya, you have done. So if you won't revise, you won't be, you know, you cannot recall the concept when it is required. GOC is something like it requires continuous, you know, revision. Okay, so in GOC, I have discussed this concept that acidity is nothing but the tendency of losing H plus ion. So you will get F minus the conjugate base. And I hope you won't ask me what is conjugate base. Yes, if you do not know, you can ask me. I'm not saying that. But I guess you know this, what is conjugate base, correct? Yeah, so these are the conjugate base we get. All these four orders are important. Okay, copy this down. Maximum size, more distribution of electron, uniform distribution, and hence it is more stable. It is more stable, I minus, so HI is the most acidic compound. Yeah, just give me 1 minute, guys, just a second. Yeah, so these are the few properties of hydrogen we have. Okay, now we'll see different compounds of hydrogen. Mainly three things we have to discuss here: hydrides, water, and hydrogen peroxide. That is it. Okay, so write down the compounds of hydrogen. That way also you can think the size is small, so bond length is small, difficult to break the bond, and hence difficult to furnish H plus ion. That way also you can think. Okay, next write down the compounds of hydrogen. We are going to discuss first hydrides. Write down, hydrogen combines with a number of elements forms compound called hydrides. Okay, so if you talk about the hydrides of hydrogen, you see this diagram, first you write down this map. Actually, hydrides, first of all, just a second, guys, just hold for a minute. या हेलो, या कैन यू हियर मी? या ओके. सो हाइड्राइड्स वी आर टॉकिंग अबाउट. सो मेनली थ्री टाइप्स ऑफ हाइड्राइड्स वी हैव. इफ यू सिंपली ट्राई टू मेमोराइज, इट विल बी डिफिकल्ट फॉर यू टू मेमोराइज. ओके, सो आई एम जस्ट गिविंग यू द पिक्टोरियल यू नो थिंग सो दैट यू कैन अंडरस्टैंड इन द पीरियोडिक टेबल हाउ दीज हाइड्राइड्स एंड देयर प्रॉपर्टीज आर. ओके, so first of all you see, like I said, there are three types of hydride. So one is, we'll discuss the property later on also. Just let me draw this. One is, we call it as ionic hydride, ionic hydride. And the second one is, we have a metallic hydride. And the third one is, we have molecular hydride or covalent hydride, or covalent hydride. These three types of hydrides we have. Now, if you you know, try to recall the entire periodic table from left to right, we are going. Okay, so S block elements that you have, S block elements forms this type of hydrides, ionic. After S block, what we have in periodic table? After S block, what we have? D block, right? Metals. So D block metals forms metallic hydrides. So this is formed by D block elements. Clear? No doubt. And after D, we have P block. So P block elements forms covalent hydrides. Okay. So CH4 is covalent, P block. NH3 is covalent. Okay. We can have YH2 metallic. YH3 metallic. Okay, LaH 0.56 metallic hydrides, NaH ionic hydrides. Okay, LiH ionic hydrides. Okay, CaH2 ionic hydrides. Okay, so this you understand the periodic table. S block ionic, then metallic, and then covalent. Fine. Yes or no? Correct. Now in this we have an exception. Exception is what? All S block forms ionic hydrides except beryllium and magnesium. Beryllium and magnesium forms covalent hydride, BeH2 and MgH2. We'll have here the examples. And lanthanum is there, no? Group 3, you see scandium, then yttrium, and then lanthanum. Madhav, group 3 elements, if you see, on the top we have scandium, then yttrium, and then lanthanum. Correct? So this is the exception. We have BeH2 and MgH2. In fact, on a micro level, if you see, BeH2 is completely covalent. MgH2 is partly covalent, partly ionic, but its covalent character is more than its ionic character. Okay, a reason we have that is Fezzan's rule. I will discuss that. Fezzan's rule we have already done, right? So reason is Fezzan's rule here. We have more polarization, and hence more polarization means more covalent character. Remember that. So this is a brief introduction of hydrides. Did you understand it? Okay. Now further, this covalent hydride is classified into three categories. That is electron deficient. Deficient. Don't write this. Okay. Electron rich. Sorry. Electron precise. And then electron rich. So we'll discuss this one by one, the hydrides that forms. No. If you have to choose between the one, suppose the option is given, MgH2 is ionic. Option is like this. MgH2 is covalent. MgH2 is partly ionic, partly covalent. Then we'll go with this one, partly ionic, partly covalent. Yes. You need to write this entire thing. You need to write. Okay. But if you have to choose between ionic and covalent, will go with covalent, not ionic. For MgH2, I'm talking about. Yes, Adrija? Yeah. So it depends what option we have. If the option contains partially ionic, partially covalent, then we'll go with that. Otherwise, if you have to choose in between ionic and covalent, we'll go with covalent, not ionic, because its covalent character is more. Copy this down, and then we'll see this one by one. Some properties also we'll discuss. Copy it, all of you. Madhav, run. Yeah. So first type of hydrides, write down. That is ionic hydrides. Ionic hydrides, we also call it as salt-like hydrides. Salt-like hydrides. Or we also call it as saline hydrides. Okay, so this is the three different names, all are same only. This type of hydrides are formed by elements of group 1 and group 2 except beryllium and magnesium. Beryllium and magnesium forms covalent hydrides along with P block. Reason is Fezzan's rule. Okay, small size, more polarization, and covalent character. Okay, properties you write down. The first one, thermal stability. Thermal stability of these hydrides decreases down the group. Reason is same only. As size increases, bond length increases, and thermal stability decreases. So LiH is more stable than NaH. NaH is more stable than KH and RbH, etc. Okay, group 2, if you see, CaH2 is more stable than SrH2 and then BaH2. Reason is write down, as size increases down the group, lattice energy decreases. right? As size increases, lattice energy decreases, thermal stability also decreases. Next point to write down. Density of these hydrides is higher than to that of the metal from which it is formed. Okay. Because hydrogen gets, you know, insert into the pore, so mass increases and hence density increases. So density is higher. One very important property here, except lithium hydride. Write down, except lithium hydride, all other hydrides are decomposed into their parent metal on strong heating. Okay, so suppose we have an hydride, say CaH2. CaH2 ko when you heat at suppose 770 Kelvin, okay, it converts into Ca solid and H2 gas. Lithium hydride won't dissociate into this. You must keep this in mind. The first element, of any group shows some abnormal properties. What you are comparing? Stability. Yeah, group 2 hydrides are slightly more stable. One last point to write down. In this type of hydrides, the oxidation state of hydrogen is -1. -1.